Sopko, the Special Inspector General for Afghan Reconstruction. Inspector General Sopko was sworn in on July 2, 2012, after more than 30 years in oversight investigations as a prosecutor, congressional counsel, and senior federal government advisor. Mr. Sopko's government experience includes over 20 years on Capitol Hill, where he held a series of positions in both the Senate and the House. I served on staffs of the House Committee on Energy and Commerce, the Select Committee on Homeland Security, and the Senate Permanent Subcommittee on Investigations. On a more kind of personal note on this particular subject, the United States government has spent more than $60 billion in Iraq on reconstruction and aid, $110 billion to date in Afghanistan, and there is one person in the United States government who is working to develop lessons learned from that project across agencies, right? Various places are looking at what they can do in their narrow sphere, but as far as learning what the government as a whole can do better and learn from these places and take it forward into future areas, the only person with the eye on that ball is here in the room to speak with us today. And so it's a great privilege to introduce Inspector General Sopko. He'll speak for about 30 minutes, and then afterwards we'll take questions from the audience. Sir, thank you very much for joining us, and welcome to Princeton.
Thank you very much for those kind words, Dr. Shapiro. And, I must be electronic or something happened. I want to thank you as well as your colleagues, in particular Ethan and your class, which I had a great opportunity to talk to today about Afghanistan. And excuse me if I'm with the bright lights, I'm going to have to put on my glasses, which shows my age. It is a pleasure to be here at Princeton. As many of you may know from my CV, I went to one of your competitors as an undergrad and always wanted to come here to Princeton. We were one of the fighting Quakers back in the 70s and used to come up here a lot and meet friends and wish I didn't have to go back to Philadelphia. But so finally I came back. I want to talk to you about something which I personally think may be one of the most important issues that'll be facing our country, particularly as we go forward into the future. And it's something which I think anyone who is in academia or in the government is, it's important for them to know more about. And that is, how do we conduct foreign policy and foreign development and reconstruction in failed states, and particularly failed states in a post-conflict environment? I think I have the rare luxury of having worked for the last over three years in Afghanistan. So what better place to look as we go forward than that little petri dish we call Afghanistan? Now let me start by saying why we should look at Afghanistan. Because Afghanistan, our investment in Afghanistan has been unprecedented. Tomorrow, we will celebrate the 14th year of the war in Afghanistan. That's what President Bush announced, and many of you will remember, although there's some students here who probably are not old enough to remember, that announcement that he launched the planes that night. This is the longest war that the United States has fought. And I just came back from Berlin a week ago, and the Germans even noted, this is the longest military engagement Germany has been involved in since the reunification, I should say. And they weren't talking about reunification between East and West. They're talking about Bismarck reunification. So this is an unprecedented event for not only the United States, but Germany, England, and many of our allies. The mission to Afghanistan has been a mix of war fighting, counterinsurgency, humanitarian aid, and economic development. Unfortunately, it has been, to quote your great president, President Wilson, at times, quote, disturbing, confusing, bewildering, afraid of its own forces, in search not merely of its road, but even of its direction, with many voices of counsel, but few voices of vision, with much excitement and feverish activity, but unfortunately, little concert of thoughtful purpose. The excitement and feverish activity that President Wilson referred to, I would say, is indicative of the amount of money we've spent there. $110 billion for reconstruction alone. Now, to put that in some context, we're actually getting good money for our investment. $110 billion of reconstruction, but over $700 billion to actually fight the war. Now, the $110 billion is what I look at. I look at the reconstruction effort. This is more money we have spent on reconstruction or development than on any one country in the history of our republic. This is more money than we've spent in Afghanistan. We've spent more money than we spent on the entire Marshall Plan to rebuild Europe. That is what we're talking about, and that's what I say is unprecedented. And the thing to remember, the Marshall Plan lasted 5 years. We are into our 14th. There's almost $8 or $10 billion still in the pipeline of authorized, appropriated, but not yet spent, and we've just authorized another $6 billion, and we and our allies have promised billions more for years to come. Getting Afghanistan reconstruction right is critical to ensuring that Afghanistan becomes a stable nation state that will not again serve as a springboard for terrorist attacks. Getting Afghanistan reconstruction right now offers an insurance policy that our 14-year investment of 2,500 more lives that have been lost and that $1 trillion treasure was not wasted. And getting Afghanistan reconstruction right now is important because I predict we will do it again. Now, you here in Princeton, and particularly those in the Wilson School, definitely understand that history has that funny way of repeating itself. If history is any guide, the United States will be involved again in reconstructing another country steeped in insecurity, suffering from widespread corruption, facing a major narcotics problem with extremely low levels of development and government capabilities. Now, does that sound familiar to anybody? Does it sound like Iraq, part two, Syria, Yemen, or any myriad number of African and Mideastern states which now are causing national security problems for us? For that reason, I suggest we must seek to learn and improve upon our 14-year reconstruction effort in Afghanistan. The lessons we learned there are lessons we will apply in the near future. And it's something that's why I'm here today to talk about reconstruction. Taking note of those lessons learned in Afghanistan is where my small agency, with that odd tobacco-flavored acronym, SIGAR, that's SIGAR with an S, not a C, comes into play. The U.S. Congress established SIGAR in 2008, unfortunately, 7 long years after we started the war and reconstruction in Afghanistan. In part, they created it because of the tremendous amount of money being spent. And based upon their experience in Iraq, they were concerned that the oversight functions and capabilities in our government were not up to par. They needed somebody new and something different. President Obama appointed me as the Special Inspector General in 2012 to replace the original Inspector General, who was forced to resign because Congress was dissatisfied with his independence and aggressiveness. As mentioned, I am a former state prosecutor and federal prosecutor with the Organized Crime and Racketeering Section of the Department of Justice, as well as a former partner in an international law firm. And I spent over 20 years on Capitol Hill working for the likes of Senator Sam Nunn and Congressman John Dingell. From both of them, I learned that oversight is a key to Congress's action and is a key to reforming our government. Both of those gentlemen made strong, bipartisan oversight the hallmark of their careers. I learned from those two fine lawmakers that the role of a good Inspector General is to be independent and to speak truth to power. After I was appointed the IG, I told my staff that our job was to provide tough, fair, and effective oversight of the funds appropriated. I emphasized to my staff, I gave them what I call a fit be speech, a fire in the belly speech, because that's what we needed. Because the instructions I received from the executive branch as well as Congress were unambiguously short and simple. Fix it and fix it fast. With those instructions in mind, as well as the demise of my predecessor, and the fact that we were a temporary agency, I realized and firmly believe that our mission extended beyond merely filing reports, killing the proverbial trees with Congress and the executive branch agencies. And if it's one thing I learned over 30 years of looking how Washington operates, we had to reach beyond Congress, beyond those reports to the public if we wished to change how things worked or didn't in Afghanistan. It is their money, the people's money, after all, that we are overseeing, and it is their voice that can add a touch of flame to what otherwise are dry audit reports and investigative matters. Although many nameless, faceless bureaucrats have criticized the aggressiveness of our office's work, they really are upset about one thing, and one thing only. We publicize almost all of our work. It's unusual in Washington, we actually publicize it. If it's not classified or sensitive or otherwise prohibited by law, my instructions to my people is publish it, and if it's worth publishing, publicize it. Many bureaucrats in Washington, as you well know, would prefer that I improperly or illegally classify all of my reports or otherwise hide them from the press and the public. Unfortunately for them, I am also a student of history, and I remember not only what I learned from my congressional experience and from Sam Nunn and John Dingell and John Glenn and Carl Levin and others, but also from someone like your famous President Wilson, who observed, based upon his own experience, if you want to make enemies, try to change something. Likewise, when it comes to my use of publicity, again, I'm reminded of President Wilson and one of his greatest appointments to the Supreme Court, and that is of Louis Brandeis, who opined publicly that, quote, sunlight is the best disinfectant and publicity is commended as a remedy for social and industrial diseases, unquote. The need for shining such sunlight in Afghanistan is obvious. Since SIGAR's creation, we have issued 199 audits, inspections, alert letters, and other products, totally nearly 600 recommendations that have identified over $1 billion in money funds put to better use. In addition, our criminal investigators, and we are dual-hatted, we do audits as well as criminal investigations, they have conducted 883 investigations, resulting in over 100 arrests, 136 criminal charges, 100 convictions or guilty pleas, 78 sentencings, and savings of over $950 million. Let me just quickly note three recent products coming out of my office, and just to give a flavor of the breadth of issues we face. In June, we sent an inquiry to USAID, that's the Agency for International Development, inquiring about claims they made of progress with Afghan school enrollments. USAID has been claiming for some time that enrollments rose from 900,000 in 2002 to almost 8 million in 2013. We noted that USAID's claims were unverifiable, and that a number of Afghan ministers and officials had spoken publicly in the Afghan parliament of doctored statistics, non-existent schools, embezzled funds, and other problems. In August, we submitted a review to USAID concerning a $355 million power plant that we had built in Kabul, which unfortunately produced less than 1% of the energy potential for the Kabul region. We noted that the plant was designed to operate continuously, but really wasn't operating in that fashion, but was doing starting and starting, and as a result, it was being damaged. We also noted that USAID, after 10 years, still had not developed a fuel option plan for the Afghans, because this plant was designed to expend or use very expensive diesel fuel, which the Afghans neither produce nor can afford. And just 2 weeks ago, SIGAR issued an audit on a failed program to assist Afghan refugees, for which the U.S. had provided nearly $1 billion. A timely topic, I would think, for any of you who have been reading the press, because it demonstrates how success or failure in that little country called Afghanistan can reverberate across the globe, and in particular in Europe, as we've seen with the refugee crisis. Even the second largest group of refugees hitting Europe are from Afghanistan, or the third largest, depending on who you talk to. I know when I was in Germany, the Deputy National Security Advisor to the Chancellor said that they will be having over 1 million refugees hitting their border just this year alone. Unfortunately, large amounts of taxpayers' dollars, as we have hinted at, have been and continue to be lost to waste, fraud, and abuse. SIGAR professionals have documented details of U.S.-funded clinics that lack staff or medicine, schools that collapse because of shoddy construction, and contracts that weren't performed properly or at all, troop rosters that can't be verified, cash assistance that can't be traced, and many other outrages. These disasters often occur when the U.S. officials who implement and oversee the programs fail to distinguish fact from fantasy, or inputs from outputs, or outputs from outcomes and impact, and who operate, unfortunately, in a world where personal accountability is nearly non-existent. A small sample of those problems SIGAR repeatedly identifies include failure to define requirements and assess suitability and sustainability of projects, a lack of coordination within our own government, with the Afghans, and with other governments and organizations, poor planning, execution, and accountability, and, of course, theft and corruption by both American and Afghan military and civilians. Now, I don't want you to get it wrong. It has not been a total failure. We have accomplished a lot. The Afghan children are going to school. More women are going to work. There are better roads. There are better clinics. But the question we ask, and I'm required to ask in my job, is, could we have done more with less faster? And can any of those gains, And I particularly am concerned about the gains for women and children. Can they be sustained? Because as I told somebody just the other day, the cruelest joke on the Afghans is if we create something that they don't want, they don't need, and they can't sustain. And that is unfortunately the question we keep asking again and again, and we're not really satisfied with the answers we've gotten from USAID and other implementers. So that brings me to how we can improve things. And it brings me really to the subject of tonight's discussion. And I know it may sound boring to many of you, but it deals with the issue of conditionality. It's not a sexy topic, but if you want to see reconstruction working in Afghanistan, and if you want to see reconstruction working in the future, when we do this again, you have to know something about conditionality, and you have to know something about smart conditionality. Although conditionality or conditioning aid is relatively new to America's mission in Afghanistan, as many of you probably know, conditionality itself is not a new concept. The basic definition of aid conditionality, of course, is that you try to incentivize behavior that you want by either providing or withholding aid based on the aid recipient's actions. As students of international public affairs, you are all well aware of this has long been a dilemma in American foreign policy between promoting the hard interests of the United States versus promoting the softer values of the United States. Conditioning aid is one way you can try to square that circle to meet hard American goals by providing aid, but changing the value behavior of the recipient by conditioning that aid on certain changes. The history of such aid conditionality covers more than five decades. Many of you remember Senator Henry Scoop Jackson and Representative Charles Vanek, and how they authored legislation now known as the Jackson-Vanek Amendment to condition the granting of most favored nation trade status to certain countries with market economies that allowed the free immigration of their citizens, which they considered, and the United States considered, a basic human right that was denied by the former Soviet Union and many of the Soviet bloc countries during the Cold War. That was conditionality. Another example of conditionality, which is very much in the news today, is the well-known Leahy Amendment, which was offered by Senator Patrick Leahy to prohibit Department of State and Department of Defense from providing security assistance to foreign military units that violate human rights with impunity. The Leahy Amendment has caused military assistance in the past to countries with suspect human rights histories, such as Egypt, Nigeria, to be delayed, in some cases denied. More specific to Afghanistan, the U.S. has supported conditionality incentive features in international programs like the World Bank-managed Afghan Reconstruction Trust Fund and in International Monetary Fund's extended credit facility. Why is conditioning aid important? Our work in Afghanistan shows that it matters for five important reasons. First, conditionality advances the vital goals of stewardship and accountability for the vast sums of taxpayers' money that have been committed to Afghan reconstruction. Second, it reflects the reality that a shrinking U.S. and coalition presence in Afghanistan currently limits both our ability to conduct our own operations and our ability to assist the Afghans. Third, conditionality is useful in promoting the growth of institutional capacity and institutional reform within the Afghan government. Fourth, achievement of the agreed upon conditions can help maintain donor confidence and avoid disruptive or disastrous cutbacks in aid. And finally, and arguably I think the most important reason why conditionality is important, is it is a tool to ensure that rights that extend to all humanity are protected rather than lost in the fog of war. Now, conditionality doesn't come easy. It causes problems. It definitely causes tension with the aid recipient. On the one hand, the U.S. has values that it seeks to uphold, even in times of war. On the other hand, those values may pressure those in power in ways that they're not happy about, or challenge cultural norms. The recent report of sexual abuse of Afghan boys amongst U.S. military partners in Afghanistan can be seen as an example of both. The U.S. abhors the sexual abuse in all forms, and U.S. aid must be conditioned on the Afghan government responding to and prosecuting those who take part in the sexual abuse of any human being. Again, I must reiterate, we must not forget that human rights cannot afford to be lost in the fog of war. Now, fortunately, Congress agrees with SIGAR and others who have looked at this problem that conditionality is important. Last year, the then majority staff of the Senate Committee on Foreign Relations made a number of recommendations on aid to Afghanistan enforcing conditionality. They noted, quote, the U.S. should condition a higher percentage of its funding. If done properly by ensuring Afghan buy-in, conditioning U.S. assistance can improve the accountability of our aid, strengthen reform and institutions in the Afghan government, and result in better development outcomes, unquote. Commanders in the field also agree with the need for conditionality. Major General Todd Semenite, former commander of Combined Security Transition Command, Afghanistan, commonly referred to as CSTICA, I love these acronyms, told SIGAR that before he took command in 2013, we had no conditions, quote unquote, on funds flowing through CSTICA to the Afghan security forces. The urgent demands of war fighting and paramilitary policing had trumped many other considerations. I'm glad to tell you that has changed, and there are now conditions placed on U.S. assistance to the Ministry of Interior and Ministry of Defense. But most importantly, and this is the real good news, the Afghan president himself and the new unity government support conditionality and believe it is important to their future. In February of this year, I personally met with President Ghani. And during that meeting, he personally voiced his support for conditioning foreign aid to his country. And he said that he plans to use conditionality to keep his government focused on meeting performance targets, prioritizing its key tasks, and holding his ministers accountable. I must say he also pulled out my latest quarterly report, this is our quarterly report, and it was all underlined and marked up, and he had read it. It's amazing. He's an amazing man. I admire anybody who reads our work, but particularly him. And he actually, we've heard this through other sources, he actually takes our reports and calls in his ministers and sub-ministers and will rebuke them, saying, look, SIGAR found this. What are you doing about it? I only wish others would read our report as much as that. But that said, a tremendous breath of fresh air dealing with him and Abdullah, the CEO, who I've also had the opportunity to meet on occasions when I come there. Now, given that policymakers, field commanders, and the Afghan president think conditionality is important, how do the donor nations implement these conditions? Now, in 2014, General Semenite's command negotiated new letters of commitment with the Afghan Ministry of Defense and the Afghan Ministry of Interior. Those bilateral agreements describe CSTICA's conditions for providing aid. Both ministries agreed to more conditions for 2015, including nearly 50 for MOD and MOI alone. The conditions are smart conditions. They're targeted conditions, such as linking U.S. aid disbursement to Afghan ministries' use of electronic personnel information systems. and submitting core or province-level spending plans before we gave them more money, as well as for the use of military hardware. We wouldn't give it to them unless they came up with actual plans. See STICA's December 2014 commitment letter with MOD imposes the conditions that they conduct an annual 100% weapon inventory, which is great because we found serious problems with them not accounting for any of the weapons, hundreds of thousands of weapons that we gave to the MOD. And they are required to report any missing weapons due within 30 days. If discrepancies are not reconciled or resolved, see STICA can freeze deliveries and withhold some of the repair support. General Semenite told us that new iterations of the commitment letters will include more conditions and changes to close loopholes in current language. Now, in 2012, however, the U.S. and our international donor representatives met with the Afghans in Tokyo. The outcome was the Tokyo Mutual Accountability Framework, or TMAF, which set the ground rules for future assistance to Afghanistan. Now, in those, they talked about holding people accountable in Afghanistan and for developing conditions. However, in the 3 years since TMAF was agreed to, I'm sorry to report that with the exception of General Semenite and General Campbell, who just testified today before the Senate on Afghanistan, little has changed. Despite the ever-growing need for such conditions and a willing partner we have in the new unity government, little has changed. Now, just this month, we had what's called the senior officials meeting, where donor nations and the national unity government reevaluated the TMAF, and like many meetings, they renamed it. It's now called the Self-Reliance Through Mutual Accountability Framework, or SMAF. I do love these acronyms. Only the military can come up with them. No, I should say the embassies do that too. SMAF calls for the National Unity Government, which is NUG, to, quote, implement administrative measures and enact and enforce the legal framework for fighting the underlying drivers of corruption, following a policy of zero tolerance, put in place mechanisms to review and implement the independent joint anti-corruption monitoring and evaluation committee's plan to reduce corruption, and that's a good thing to do. Ensure the institutionalization of the National Procurement Committee, something that President Ghani set up, that's good, and guarantee new government officials under Constitution Article 154 declare their assets, something that the prior government in Afghanistan agreed to do but never did. Now, I will say, beyond the new name SMAF and these lofty pronouncements, I am not certain any concrete changes in the realm of anti-corruption and conditionality will occur. We await further developments, and I can assure you on my next trip, which will be in a couple weeks to Afghanistan, I'm going to ask both our embassy and the new unity government about whether there's going to be any tangible and realistic changes in conditionality. I cannot reiterate enough. Simply having conditions for aid does not guarantee the desired outcomes or behavioral changes any more than the discovery of penicillin eliminated all pathogens. As the World Bank noted in a 2005 report on conditionality, quote, more conditionality cannot compensate for weak government commitment or implementation capacity, unquote. And that, unfortunately, is really applicable in Afghanistan. In addition, conditionality cannot be fully effective without a buy-in from the willing partner. Quote, governments will agree to almost anything to obtain aid. And that's a quote from the National Academy of Public Administration, who was looking at failed reconstruction in Haiti. Recipient nation leaders may be focused on opportunities for short-term control of funds and unconcerned about longer-term outcomes. They may construct compliance charades like enacting high-sounding but unenforceable laws or concealing day-to-day practices. They may be willing to tolerate penalties for failing to enact reforms they do not actually want, or they may simply lack the political administrative clout to deliver compliance in the first place, but agree to conditions in the hope that their failures will be no consequence, will result in no consequence. This is something I have been harping about for over 2 years. We have to have the guts, be brave enough to say no in Afghanistan. If Afghanistan doesn't live up to the conditions, we have to be willing to risk saying no. Something which, with the exception of General Semeny and General Campbell recently, most of our aid officials have not had that ability or willingness to do. Because once aid starts to flow, as the National Academy noted, political pressures may keep it flowing despite waste, despite the lack of enforcement of the conditions, because, quote, cutting off or slowing assistance can wreck or undo progress, as reported back to your parliaments or Congress. This phenomena can lead to other problems. Aid agencies, quote, often fail to enforce conditions. This pattern undermines the credibility of conditionality, weakens incentives, and destroys the chance of implementing real reform. Whether the lack of conditionality enforcement rigor stems from unclear requirements, loss aversion, security concerns, or other sources, the effects can be pernicious. Aid-receiving country leaders may conclude that donors' political sensitivities about the perception of failure back home, reluctance to write off gains, or prioritization of strategic over developmental objectives will shield them against donor enforcement of conditions. Even worse, perhaps, actually cutting off aid may not achieve the intended incentivization effect if the impact falls on the wrong people. You know, I had a conversation with General Semeny the last time I traveled to Afghanistan. I remember he's in charge of our aid to the Afghan military and police. And he shared with me a especially perplexing dilemma. You know, do you cut off fuel and bullets and guns to the Afghan National Security Forces right in the middle of a battle, a la what's going on in Kunduz? Well, how do you handle conditionality then? Well, it may succeed, but unfortunately, they'll lose the battle. Now, I'm not saying that happened in Kunduz, but that's a problem he faces every day. So what he did was smart conditionality. He found out what the commanders, the guy he's dealing with, what were their favorite toys? What did they personally want? Whether it was travel to the United States, new cars, some fancy building or whatever. And he would cut back on that, but not cut back on the useful tools that were needed for the troops to carry out their mission. So he penalized those commanders by taking away their toys and defunding pet projects. That's smart conditionality that General Semeny and General Campbell have been attempting in the last few years. Now, to help alleviate some of the aforementioned problems, SIGAR has developed 10 preparatory tasks that may assist U.S. policymakers in practicing smart conditionality. They're all located in this quarterly report. I'm not going to bore you with all 10 tonight. You can find this online. I want to focus just on three, and these are the three most important. And that deals with coordinating conditionality, the feasibility of conditionality, and sustainability. First on coordination. Biggest problem we see is we're not coordinating enough with our allies. We're not coordinating enough internally. We may do conditionality, but gee, nobody talked to the Japanese. They may do the program. We may do conditionality, the Germans may do conditionality, and we ignore it and we do it on our own. So the important thing is, we have to realize the U.S. is not the only country engaged in reconstruction. It's critical we coordinate with our partners to reduce or avoid contradictions and burdens. If we don't, The contradictions and conditions undermines our efforts. That's common sense. But I've noted in Afghanistan, common sense is usually one of the first things that's lost when you get off the airplane. The second thing is feasibility. Our conditionality needs to be feasible. It's crucial when thinking about aid conditions up feasibility. If feasibility is not considered, the Afghan government could do everything in its power to meet the conditions, but ultimately would fail because what we asked them was not possible for them to do. It's critical when we think about conditionality that we link a realistic causal link between their achievement and overall goals. And we also ensure that the Afghans understand and support our conditionality and what we're asking of them. The third issue is sustainability. I harp on that. General Martin Dempsey, when he was testifying, the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs, when he was testifying about Iraq, talked about conditionality and said support needs to be conditional. But he said the important thing is if we don't consider sustainability, if the conditions, if what we're asking them to do doesn't last, then it's like painting over rust. While General Dempsey was discussing Iraq, the idea of conditionality needs to breed sustainability applies to Afghanistan and future conflicts as well. We do not have unlimited treasure or resources, and our efforts need to be able to sustain themselves over time. Conditionality is one way to ensure host governments are working to build self-sustaining institutions and processes. Now, in conclusion, I think, as the recent news from Kunduz highlights, we are at a crossroads in Afghanistan. The National Unity Government is a willing, though still weak, partner. President Ghani himself wants conditionality. The key is having the will and the knowledge on our side to institute smart conditions on our aid to Afghanistan. Ensuring the conditions we set are smart will certainly be difficult. But again, as your President Wilson once said, the man who is swimming against the stream knows the strength of it. The fact that we feel that stream and we feel the strength of it doesn't mean we should stop swimming or, in this case, fighting to ensure enforceable but smart conditions. Conditions that are feasible, coordinated, and sustainable. I firmly believe that applying more forethought and care to aid conditionality can bring great benefits to the American taxpayer, U.S. strategic and humanitarian goals, and the people of Afghanistan. But as a very highly respected ambassador told me within days of my starting work 3 years ago, and he warned me about conditionality, and he said, quote, "In order for conditionality to work, John, we not only have to hold the Afghans' feet to the fire, we have to hold our own, too. Many times, the weakest partner is really the U.S. and its allies on conditionality. We give up before the Afghans do." I hope you agree with me, and for those of you starting careers or returning to careers in the federal government or NGO community, we'll keep this in mind about conditionality. Best practices and lessons learned are only good if they're actually followed and implemented. I think back to my days when I worked with Sam Nunn, and we were working in the former Soviet Union. The former Soviet Union had the best constitution in the world, better than ours, but it was only worth what the paper it was printed on because it was never enforced. That's what we got to remember about conditionality in Afghanistan. Otherwise, conditionality is just going to be a bunch of empty slogans and press releases or platitudes. I want to thank you again for the opportunity to speak. And since I've already quoted President Wilson a couple times, I'll quote him one more time. President Wilson said he uses not only all the brains he has, but also all the brains he can borrow. And that's the way I run SIGAR. Accordingly, I look forward to your questions, your thoughts, your suggestions, and criticisms. Thank you very much. Now, I think I have not run over, so I'll...
No, so we have about 25 minutes for questions, so if you'd like to ask a question, please come up to one of the mics here, and or project loudly so everyone can hear, and let the inspector respond.
Thank you.
Hello. Thank you very much for coming to speak today. My name is Andrew Hanna. I'm a senior in the Department of Near Eastern Studies. My question pertains to conditionality and national security. There's a story in the New York Times earlier this year about how $1 million in cash payments from the CIA to Kabul ended up directly in the hands of Al-Qaeda in a cash transfer for a hostage payment of an Afghanistan diplomat. My question is, what can SIGAR do to improve oversight over parts of the national security apparatus that are as secretive and independent as the CIA, or rather, how that aid is spent by the Afghanistan government itself?
Well, first of all, we only do reconstruction, so we don't have jurisdiction over the CIA per se or any of the intelligence units. Where there's an overlap with reconstruction, we actually, I had a memorandum of agreement with the CIA IG, so anything we found, we would refer to him, and likewise, if doing his work, he referred to us. So I can't really think of anything specifically we can do other than we signed that agreement, and the reason we did it is basically, by the time my people got cleared for all the CIA programs or security programs, I mean, they do have clearances, but that's a long and involved process. We'd probably be done with our work by the time my people were cleared. His people were cleared, and they could do it. So that's how we handled it.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, I'm Mae Lindsay. I'm a first-year Master in Public Affairs student here at the Woodrow Wilson School.
Great.
And my question for you is, SIGAR does most of its evaluations based on quick impact assessments. How does your team ensure that the results from these quick impact assessments are reliable?
Well, we actually don't do it on just quick impact assessments. Our reviews are, we do audits, which usually take 6 to 9 months to do. Inspections, which take about the same amount of time. As well as in criminal investigations, which God only knows how many years some of these take. So it's not quick impact. We do what we call special project reports, and those are the quick impact you're talking about. And the reason we created special projects is because I walked around and talked to the ambassadors, the generals, the aid officials, and I said, what do you need? And they said, well, look it. By the time you get done with your audit, like most auditors do, the program is probably over. You know, it's very much like one of these criminal detective shows you see on TV. By the time we show up, the body's been carted out and there's just a chalk outline on the floor. So we wanted to do these quick impact studies. They don't follow GAGAS, usually. GAGAS, for those of you who like acronyms, it's generally accepted government accounting standards. Those are what we apply to our audits and investigations. It uses an approach that SIGI, which is the Council of Inspector Generals in Integrity and Efficiency, has come with. So we try to verify all the facts we can, but the idea is to get something out fast so that the ambassadors, the generals, can use the information right now on a program before it ends.
Thank you.
Okay? Sure, no problem. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Fantastic. The gold standard for assistance, DFID. Yes.
Certainly, kind of from my experience, that conditionality at the top needs to be complemented system and you can sit with ministers who you genuinely concern about the conditions, but their ability to actually instrument that and run it through the system is weak. And one of the things certainly that we experimented with was much more using not just conditionality at the top, but also local monitoring committees, getting local communities trying to strengthen accountability to those communities to aid how it was spent at the field level. And I wonder if that was an issue that SIGAR had looked at as well.
I don't think we've actually done an audit on that, but I think you hit an important point. We have a tendency to focus just on the central government, not out to the provinces and not out to the districts, and you do have to design programs. What this is just using common sense. When DFID approaches Afghanistan or aid, or when DFID approaches Haiti or whatever country you're in, you should know the environment. You know, we spend so many billions and trillions of dollars on intel. And it's amazing. We can know which little hole in a cave some guy is so we can bomb him. But we don't understand how a country operates. And it just flabbergasts me. Now, this isn't meant as a criticism against DFID. I think DFID actually does a better job than we do. But you have to understand how Afghanistan worked before you went in. And what are the trigger points you want to touch? And who's related to whom, whether it's by family or by tribe or whatever, and design your program accordingly. We really didn't do that. There were a lot of Afghan hands who were ignored when we created these programs and specifically when we implemented these programs. And I don't know if that's the same problem that DFID faced, but you're absolutely on point. I don't know if you faced the same problem with DFID, but we saw it and see it all the time. Somebody says, well, I worked in Iraq, so I know how to do water in Afghanistan. Or I worked in Iraq, so I know about terrorist financing in Afghanistan. Or I worked in Iraq, or I worked in Haiti, or I worked in Yemen, or I worked someplace else. They're totally different countries. All of them are. Now, it's great that you have experience as a Peace Corps volunteer in Guatemala, but I don't know if that's the expertise I want to rely upon in trying to design a counterterrorism program or trying to design a water program in Kunduz. And that's something we're actually working with some of your colleagues here at Princeton, looking at personnel issues. Lessons learned from the personnel you hire, and how do you appoint them, how long do they stay in theater, and what kind of expertise you have. So, answering your question, yes, we're aware of that problem, and no, we don't have it right. And that's why we're doing this lessons learned program, trying to figure out how to do it better. And again, I would say DFID is, I'm sorry about the light here, I'm not raising my hand to be called upon, but DFID is known as the gold standard. And I spent some time talking to DFID about their approach. DFID doesn't do direct assistance either. Very interesting. On-budget assistance. USA, because it's too risky in Afghanistan. The Germans don't need to do on-budget assistance. This is a sort of a gripe we have. But USAID does direct assistance than the U.S. government does. So it's different approaches. We can learn. Not that DFID has all the answers, but we can learn by talking to our allies on their various approaches to aid in Afghanistan. I hope that answers the question, but if not, remember, I get paid by the word as an ex-attorney, so thank you. I'll answer it again. If you don't like that answer, I'll give you another one. So, yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Lily Lee, and I'm a professor at UPenn.
You've at Penn?
Yes, you're
another fighting Quaker. I can tell. Good.
You mentioned Japan and Germany and maybe other allies several times. Can you expand on how that work is coordinated and what kind of support do they provide? Is it primarily monetary or do they actually go in? And a follow-up question on that is, on the conditionality, is part or some of the conditionality would be that if they get into some of the major infrastructure projects that the company or the parties that would be involved in that would have to be from US or Germany or Japan?
Let me try to answer that. On the question about how the other countries, and I want to make certain I understand the question, but how the other countries do aid in Afghanistan, how they do, well, every one of them does it a little differently. Many of them give a lot of money to the Afghans through what they call sort of international trust funds. I think DFID gives quite a bit through the international trust funds, and they allow either the World Bank or the UN to monitor, oversee, and deliver that assistance. Some, like the Germans, use they give money through the funds, but they also have an implementer called GIZ, for short. I don't know what that stands for in German, but if it is, it's a very long word, and I don't remember it. My college German is poor. But there, they actually have set up a government-owned but private corporation to implement their assistance. It's a very novel approach, not really used by many other agencies. And they actually, before they go in and accept a contract from their government to implement a program, they actually do a risk assessment, they get buy-in from the community, and they won't implement the government program of Germany unless they get total buy-in from the community, which is a very interesting approach. May not be the approach we can use in the United States, but it's an interesting approach. And as a result, when they operate in Afghanistan, they have no security, per se. You don't see GIZ people out there with a whole bunch of armed guards with guys with beards and machine guns, like a lot of our aid programs do, because they get buy-in from the community. And so far it has worked, sort of. Recently, security's gotten bad for them. I don't know how Japan actually does their aid. There are people in my office who know that a lot better. But each country has a different approach to aid there. Each country has their own conditions. And I've heard this complaint from the Afghans. And I understand, you know, you got 20-some countries giving money, plus international organizations, plus just some private organizations. Each one of them have separate rules, separate accounting requirements, separate conditions. And that's why we really need to coordinate. Now, we have heard of instances where we have come in, or let's say the Germans have come in, or the Brits, and done something and put conditions on it, and the Afghans refused, because they'd go over to another country and get the same thing. Now, we've also heard situations where three different governments are paying for the same thing. That happens probably more often than we think, because, you know, if you can make a buck, I think people are doing it. And that's the tragedy of it. We poured so much money into Afghanistan, we didn't really coordinate it, and you spend that much money that fast in that poor country with such poor oversight, you're bound to have a lot of fraud, waste, and abuse. And that's what we're seeing. So I don't know if that totally answers your question. You'd almost have to, I'd have to spend an hour going down, and there are smarter people in my shop. Go on my website, see if we can, I feel like I'm selling some product. Go on my website, you'll see. You'll get the miracle drug. It's not a miracle, but we try to collect. I will say this, and I know this poor gentleman's waiting. When I took over SIGAR, I wanted these quarterly reports to be sort of the go-to place if you wanted to learn anything about reconstruction in Afghanistan. Because I talked to my clients, the Congress, I talked to agencies. Some of our U.S. agencies only learn about what other U.S. agencies are doing by looking at our report. But I also wanted institutions such as Princeton, or CSIS, or any of the think tanks in town to be able to go here and find it useful. Because the way I view it is, my clients are the American people. And it's not just ambassadors and generals, it's also people in institutions like Princeton, and of course Penn, who can take this information and it helps them. So I extended the offer. Every time I go to a university or think tank, if there's some research you're doing, and it's credible research, it's not just trying to, you know, not partisan research or anything, but credible research, and there's information that you think you need for credible research, call me. Call my people. And we put the greatest data call that the government sees every quarter. I have a staff of really smart people who send out a data call to all of the agencies that report on what's happened in Afghanistan on reconstruction for the last quarter. And it's, I know, because we get complaints all the time from General Campbell and C. Sticka and all these other people because we're asking us information. But that's a requirement Congress wanted. Congress wanted to know what was going on. So that's why we do this. And I'm sorry, sir, I kept you waiting.
I'm Arvind Shah. I'm a management consultant who has worked with many national and international corporations, as well as the domestic and international governments. What we find, even if you have good methodology or good project, it's very important to understand the management culture and the social norms of that organization. And are the people who are affected receptive to whatever we take? So there are so many factors. So you, in order to assess feasibility, you have to really invest quite much amount of resources and understanding and people power to really come up with the right kind of conditions. So this is my one question. Do you really, or does the government really have that much resources available before they come up with a project with conditions, to put those conditions? Number two, there are always external pressures, like some lobbying. If some company who has contributed quite much amount to the campaign of one political congressman or senator, naturally there will be a pressure from that company to push their products. So you are in a hurry to support them, and you may not have enough time to really conduct the feasibility of conditions and the project's success. So these are my two questions. Do we have enough amount of resources to do right kind of feasibility study? And number two, how much pressure do you get from external lobbying sources?
Okay. As for my office, we get pressure occasionally from people, but that's what we do for a living, and it's no big deal. I mean, we don't cave into the pressure. Do agencies get pressure on projects? Yeah, of course. I've been doing this for 30 years. Of course, there's a lot of pressure. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad. I mean, that's just the nature of the beast. There's a lot of money sloshing around in not only Afghanistan, but also Northern Virginia and elsewhere. So obviously there's a lot of interest and a lot of pressure in that. As to whether we have the resources, by we, you mean SIGAR, our resources are okay. Whether the agencies have enough resources, yeah, they do, to come up with smart conditionality and to carry them out. Now, one issue you haven't talked about, and we haven't talked about tonight, is security. The security situation in Afghanistan is deteriorating. It's deteriorating rapidly and dramatically. And as a result, it is more difficult for those aid officers, those diplomats, those military men to get out there, military men and women, to get out there and oversee and manage programs. That is the reality. The reality is we're doing redevelopment in a country where people are trying to kill you, and not just me. Because as one security officer told me, Mr. Sopko, it's more dangerous for you inside the embassy than outside the embassy. That was meant as a joke, guys. I didn't know. Well, it fell flat. That is a difficult situation. And so the ability to do monitoring, management, and oversight remotely or using third parties to do it is a tricky thing that we're trying to deal with, and I know all of the agencies are trying to deal with. But that's the other issue we all face. So I hope that answers your question. Sir.
Yes, I wonder if you would comment on the complexities that the relationship with Pakistan is compounding some of your difficulties in dealing with the Afghan government as they go back and forth, such as the raid into Pakistan that caused such a great deal of trouble. And secondly, the increasing flow of opium through the northern borders of Afghanistan, which is causing a lot of complex fighting between different clans, fighting over opium controls, and much as what goes on in the streets of Baltimore.
Okay.
So that, I'm sure, would add to your complexity.
Okay. Let me answer you. Two good questions. The first one I'm not going to be able to answer, and it has to do with Pakistan, because that's more of a foreign policy issue I don't deal with. I deal with just reconstruction. Obviously, Pakistan is an important player in that area. So is Iran. So are the other states around it. So I can't really address that. It's not my expertise. I don't do policy. I do process. The policies given by the president on reconstruction, I look at the processes, whether they're good, bad, or indifferent, to carry out those policies. So even like the question, I no one's asked, and so I'll just alleviate that right now. If you ask me a question about how many troops there should be, I can't answer that either. That's a policy decision done by the president, and it'll be the Congress, on how many troops you should have. You give me what the policy is, you, and I'll tell you how well we can carry it out and how well we are carrying it out. Now, the question on narcotics, I can't answer. So it's you're batting 500. Narcotics is a big problem. It's the 800-pound gorilla in the room. It is the gorilla that we've ignored. And we've spent $8 billion, with a B, billion dollars of that reconstruction money on countering narcotics. And if you use any indicia of success, and I've been looking at countering narcotics, well, I was a former federal prosecutor, but when I was looking at it from a policy perspective from the Congress in Colombia and Peru and Bolivia back in the 80s, you look at price, you look at purity, you look at hectares under production, you look at every indicia, we failed. The most successful crop in Afghanistan is opium. The biggest export in tonnage, opium. The biggest export in dollars, opium. The biggest amount of money going to the terrorists, opium. The number of seizures, down. The number of arrests, down. The number of Afghans who are addicted to narcotics, up. You want to see a sorry sight? Go drive around Kabul and see the addicts under the bridges shooting up. Go to Herat. They have the worst heroin addiction problem of any country out there, worse than Pakistan. So, yeah, it's a big problem. And the big problem is, I don't know if any of you read what was the New York Times the other day. They talked about the new leader of the Taliban. Did you read that article? What's his main source of income? His personal narcotics. So it was President Ashraf Ghani, before he was president, back when he was finance minister under the Karzai regime, who said, if we don't do something about narcotics in Afghanistan, we're going to create a narco-terrorist state. He said that, not a little SIGAR. I keep raising that issue. We keep banging the drum. Now, again, I don't do policy. I do process. And if you want to cut the funding to the Taliban, you got to do something about narcotics. If you want to cut the corruption, the corrupting influence on your central government, you got to deal with narcotics. We haven't. So other than that, how was the play, Mrs. Lincoln? So what? I'm sorry? I'm sorry?
All we need to do is go to Trenton.
Go to Trenton?
We'll see it all there.
Oh, well, no, actually we don't. We can't go to Trenton. I've been there. Don't go there. No. great place. What Trenton makes, the world takes. Remember that. Most of our opium comes from Latin America, South America. Now, this is an odd little statistic, and I know poor lady has been standing there and is probably bored. But it is interesting. The Canadians say over 90% of their opium comes from Afghanistan. DEA says less than 4% of U.S. opium comes from Afghanistan. Now, I don't do domestic U.S. narcotics issues, but it is it's an interesting dilemma. I don't have an answer to it, but most of the European narcotics comes from Afghanistan. Actually, 90% of all opium in the world comes from Afghanistan. Let's not beat around the bush. You know, it's a great success story if you're a narcotics dealer. So, ma'am, you've been waiting.
Yep, and we'll take one more question.
Okay.
Well, I'm just getting hot. I'm just getting, yeah.
I'm a retired USAID Foreign Service Officer.
U.S. Foreign Service Officer?
USAID Foreign Service Officer. I served in TDYs in Afghanistan five times.
Good for you.
From 2012 to 2014.
Yes.
And I want to congratulate you on the work you've done and everything you say is absolutely true. There's nothing I could disagree with, but there's one thing you haven't said that I'm surprised about, and that is the very poor design of USAID projects. And because we can't get out, because aid people are there for 1 year, they don't know anything about Afghanistan, and the projects are so poorly designed that even if there's conditionality, I mean, I've saw too many of them. You can't, and I'm surprised you haven't mentioned that, because that's sort of the root of the problem.
Yeah, okay. I haven't mentioned a lot of other problems, and I could, but they said I could only speak for 30 minutes. I'll come back a second time and we can talk about it. No, I don't want to dump on aid, USAID. Everybody thinks I don't like USAID. Actually, I'm a strong defender of foreign assistance. I think it's a necessary part of our government. It's necessary for our foreign policy. It's necessary for our national security. And it's also necessary from a humanitarian point of view. But you are right. USAID has changed. And the design of the programs, and we're looking at some of the designs of the programs. And two things I want to say. None of those people who are working for aid or state or the military are evil people. They don't go over there to say, gee, I just want to, how can I waste money today? They don't. You know that as well as I do. They're risking their lives in a horribly dangerous environment. Their family's not there. They're trying their best. But what have we done? What have we done to these poor people? We've given them a box of tools that are broken. And shame on us. Because the problems I'm identifying, and I'd like to see if you agree or disagree with me, are problems not with aid, not with state, not with DOD. They're problems with the way the government works. The problems I'm identifying in Afghanistan are the same problems afflicting the Veterans Administration, the Transportation Department, OPM, you name the government agency. Now, this isn't political, because I'm a nonpartisan type of guy. This is the reality of the situation. And this is why I'm speaking to you tonight, not because I'm running for office, but I'm speaking to you tonight because it's important that people realize so many of these things that she mentioned are broken here in the United States. And when you take them to a war zone, it's like being on steroids. It's just crazier than hell out there. And then on top of that, they're shooting at us. So, look at the high risk list that GAO came out with in 1991. You'll find DOD procurement. Has it been fixed? Look at the books that my good friend Tom Ricks has written about the generals and the military, and the HR system, the way we rotate troops, has been broken since the Korean War. Has it been fixed? Look at a personnel system that rewards waste rather than effect, and you know as well as I do, and any of you served in Afghanistan or Iraq, you probably met somebody, or maybe you were in that situation where your performance review was not based upon outcome, but it was based upon output or inputs. That's why I made the point. Inputs, outputs, outcome. Input is how much money you put in. I've had more than a dozen contracting officers or ex-contracting officers come up to me and say, John, I got rewarded for how much money I put on contract in 6 months, and I got a bonus, not whether any of the money was spent right. Now that's a broken tool. I don't hold it against that poor contracting officer who all he or she wants to do is get a promotion, but her promotion is based upon a broken tool. That is a system problem. We have to address that. It's not just a little old SIGAR. It's every IG should be talking about that and fixing it. I don't know who owns my personnel records now, but due to the OPM, and when is the last time you heard an OPM IG come out here and talk about we're going to fix the personnel system? But all I know is that's broken. They can't protect my records. God only knows if I'm ever going to retire from the federal government. I hope you got your retirement check because I'm still waiting for mine. I'll maybe call up the Chinese embassy and see if they can give it to me. Ooh, probably not politically correct, but somebody, maybe some guy in Bratislava who probably has my payroll check. But that's the problem we're dealing with. And a lot of the programs and strategy, I mean, it's the same thing. How do you get rewarded in AID? It's coming up with a nifty program, a good press release. What the heck if it has anything to do with the truth? And that's what I say. We're not going to win the war in Afghanistan or Iraq or Syria or any place else by press release. It's by people like yourself on the ground speaking truth to power. Now, I don't condemn people for not doing that. You see, if you speak truth to power as an aid official or a DOD official or an OPM official or HHS official, you'll probably get fired. I hate to say it. I mean, that's the reality of the situation. You're going to get fired, you're going to get demoted, or you're going to get sent to Siberia. That's reality. I've been looking at this since 1977. A whistleblower's life is tough. And I have counseled many of them as an investigator, as an IG, and as well as a private attorney. And God bless every one of them. My job is to take those arrows, to take the pushback, to take the flack, but I need to hear from you. I don't mean to point you, every one of you. That's why I go to Afghanistan. That's why I go to meetings of contractors. We get some of the best information about screw-ups from contractors. They will come in and say, you can't believe what AID required us to do. You can't believe what DOD did. You can't believe, I mean, the greatest thing was, I remember some contractor telling me this. He says, at some point, John, you're going to find a base. One of these bases we're turning over to the Afghans. And on one side, there'll be a contractor building it. And on the other side, a guy destroying it. And they'll meet in the middle. And lo and behold, we found a base like that. Because the one hand doesn't know what the other. If you look at the 64,000 square foot building, the headquarters down in Camp Leatherneck, which caused a great stir, it had never been used. The general on the ground, all the generals on the ground said, we don't want it, we don't need it, don't build it. They built it anyway. In the course of them demobilizing the base, the DODIG comes in and says, you got a problem with your fire extinguishers, and so they repair the fire extinguishers and fire escapes, spend hundreds of thousands more dollars on a building that's going to be turned over to the Afghans and destroyed. You can't make this up. This is the reality, and I'm certain over a drink, you could probably come up with some screwy stories in Afghanistan with aid. It is amazing. It is amazing that we have embarked upon a very, very complicated and very expensive program aid has called Promote, and the goals are fantastic to help Afghan women. But we've embarking upon a $500 million program right now when nobody from AID can leave the embassy. And I just raised that concern. I'm not opposed to it, but how are you going to implement it when security's going to hell in a handbasket? Now, do you realize when I travel to Afghanistan and everybody under the chief of mission, those are people who work in the embassy, when we travel to Afghanistan, we cannot drive the 1.5-mile distance from the airport to the embassy. because the security situation is so bad. We have to be helicoptered in and out. That's how bad security is, and that's how tough it is for your colleagues in aid and DOD and state. But that's the reality. Let's face reality. It's like I told somebody in my office the other day, came in with a, here's what I'm going to do for you, boss. Here, we're going to start in this date. We're going to finish this report in that date. And he laid it all out. And I said, I won't use his name. I said, you're not going to make any of those deadlines, are you? You're not going to meet one of those deadlines. You're going to have to push that whole thing over 6 months to the right. And he looked at me sheepishly. Yeah, you're right, boss. Ain't going to make the deadlines. I said, then why lie to me? Tell me what you need. I can hire more people for you. We can lessen your responsibilities. We can do that. But if you lie to me, if you phony it up, I'm going to find out eventually because you're not going to make the deadlines, and then I'm going to yell and scream and say, why did you lie to me? That's the same thing with aid and state and DOD. Let's fess up to the American people. You know something? The American people are pretty smart. I think they'd like to hear the truth. I think the Afghans would like to hear. That's the funny thing is the Afghans know what the truth is. The only people who don't are the taxpayers in the United States. You know, it's so funny. I remember aid getting very upset that I released some data and on the capabilities of the Afghan ministries. And they're all corrupt. And the USAID found this. And I said, well, hold it. Who said we can't release this stuff? I mean, the U.S. taxpayer paid for the studies. And he said, oh, well, that would embarrass the Afghans. I said, hold it, time out. We paid for the program. We did the audit. But you're saying the Afghans will be embarrassed. The Afghans know their ministries are corrupt. It's only the Congress and the American taxpayer who doesn't. And we can't fix it if we don't talk about it. So that said, I'm running over time. I know we got it kicked out because I think something else is happening here. I really enjoy this. Did you? Oh. Thank you. Go to our website if you want to learn more about it, and keep following the issue. It's important. Just because the troops are coming home doesn't mean it's over in Afghanistan. Thank you very much.